The Philippine Justice Department creating teams tasked with ensuring that sellers comply with the rice price ceiling. According to Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Rimulya, the DOJ is studying charges that could be filed against violators. These include economic sabotage and profiteering. He also warns price manipulators and hoarders of legal consequences.
Nagbubuo pa kami ng mga team na iikot din sa mga merkado upang tingnan mismo ang mga pangyayari sa mga iba't ibang mga merkado. Meron tayong batas na pinagbabawal ang ganitong mga pagkilos na hindi dapat ginagawa sa taong bayan. At kung ito talaga ay kanilang pipilit gawin, ay ang batas po ang kanilang makakaharap.
The palace defends the multi-million peso transfer of confidential funds to Vice President Sara Duterte last year. Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin insisted the move was legal, as he said Duterte needed the funds for her programs when she ascended to office. He says the release of the budget was made through a special provision under the government's contingent fund. Bersamin's remarks followed criticism from progressive lawmakers that Duterte possessed confidential funds that were not included in the 2022 spending bill.
A House panel approves without question the proposed 10.7 billion peso budget of Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. The House Appropriations Committee swiftly ended deliberations on account of parliamentary courtesy. Vice President Sara Duterte's proposed budget was approved by the House panel by the same motion last August 30. Progressive House lawmakers accused their colleagues of railroading deliberations for the president's budget. Members of the Makabayan Bloc called out the growth of confidential and intelligence funds for Marcos and Duterte. The president is seeking 4 billion pesos in confidential funds. A House lawmaker wants a state of national rice emergency in the Philippines. Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo filed a bill seeking to empower President Marcos to declare a national emergency amid supply issues and elevated prices of the staple. The state of emergency would be managed by various government agencies, including the Agriculture Department, which Marcos concurrently heads. The government will have the power to pay out rice subsidies, authorize limited imports, and penalize acts of economic sabotage. Kimbo noted the declaration would be in place for a maximum of 6 months, unless sooner withdrawn by the president or revoked by Congress. To Jakarta now, where the 43rd ASEAN Summit officially kicked off this Tuesday. President Marcos, during the plenary session, pushed for a rules-based multilateral trading, which he said is key to integration within the region. He also vowed to advocate for efforts to maintain the competitiveness of the ASEAN's economy.
To further expand mutual trade, we should continue efforts at enhancing ASEAN connectivity and supply chains. We remain optimistic that RCEP will not only widen our options to increase production and ultimately strengthen supply chain resiliency, but also provide a new space for our economies to participate in the global value chain. Excellencies, our growth only matters when it is inclusive.
The Philippine leader is expected to meet with the ASEAN Business Council this afternoon. Marcos also announced that Manila will host the ASEAN Summit in 2026.
The Philippines will continue to champion for change that will strengthen our institutions, improve our decision-making, and uphold ASEAN centrality. To this end, it is my pleasure to announce that the Philippines is ready to take the helm and chair of ASEAN in 2026.
A former Philippine senator believes a government should allocate more funds for the free college education program. Bamakino told Teleradio Serbisyo, while there is no issue with reviewing the system, its funds should not be slashed. Aquino is one of the principal sponsors of the bill advocating for free education in state colleges.
Ang budget ay priority. May pera yan kung gusto mong pondohan ang isang bagay. Walang pera kung ayaw mong pondohan ang isang bagay. Kung edukasyon ang pinag-uusapan, dapat priority yan. Pondohan. Dapat binibigyan talaga yan ng pondo ahead of other expenses ng ating gobyerno.
The Philippine Coast Guard allays fears of another catastrophic oil spill after a vessel sank off the coast of Naga, Cebu. Let's get more details now from our correspondent, Rafael Busano. Raf?
Hi, Ron. The Philippine Coast Guard assures the public that the oil spill that happened off the coast of Naga, Cebu is not or will not be as catastrophic as the one that was experienced in Mindoro. PCG spokesperson Rear Admiral Arman Balilo says that the PCG has deployed personnel to observe and conduct oil spill prevention measures after 8,600 liters of diesel and 1,200 liters of lube oil were let out by the tugboat. The cause of the sinking and subsequent spill was a hole in the boat's hull. Balilo adds that what they are focusing more on is the containment and absorption of lube oil. He explains that diesel usually dissipates, which is why they aren't as worried about this. Aside from containing the oil spill, they are also working hard to minimize its effects on navigation. Now, the PCG is currently coordinating with the tugboat's owners to know what transpired in full and whether or not they are liable for any possible damages. Ron.
Rafael Busano with that story. Thanks. The People's Law Enforcement Board in Quezon City says the statements of cyclist Alan Bandiola who will not have an effect on their probe. Pleb Chair Attorney Rafael Kalinisan said their investigation will evaluate whether authorities acted in accordance with protocol. Last Friday, Attorney Raymond Fortun filed charges against the first responders and investigators over their alleged mishandling of the case. Despite this, Bandiola believes he was not mistreated by authorities.
Actually, it is interesting, his statements, but still, we don't really need his statement in the pleb because what is in question here is the actions or non-action of our policemen. The policemen who first responded, the policemen in Kamuning who first investigated, and the policeman in Galas who last investigated. So, ang tanong dito, ikukumpara natin yung kanilang actions or none of it dun sa police manual. Ano ba ang nire-require ng police manual? From there, we can make an informed decision. We will first hear them out, of course, the policemen. But in the end, if there really should, if accountability should be extracted, then so be it.